On our very first show, we put the question to the audience, who do you want to see on the show? And on our very first show, I remember that first day, we got about 5 emails saying, we want to see Stone Cold Steve Austin. We've done probably 200 shows since then, at least 5 a day, maybe 10, sometimes 20, our most requested guest ever. So you can probably guess who is here, Stone Cold Steve Austin. Thanks for joining us today. DTA, Steve.
Don't trust anybody, right? All right, don't turn your back.
I'm sorry?
Don't turn your back on me.
Absolutely.
All right.
Well, that's why the chairs are facing in this direction. You are the current WWF heavyweight champion. You are probably the most popular wrestler in the world and one of the most popular wrestlers of all times. But here's what Eric Bischoff, your former boss, had to say about you. Take a look.
Right now, today, Steve Austin would be a mid-card player. The fact is Steve Austin is a big fish in a relatively small pond when it comes to a talent roster. And he's doing very well. I don't want to take anything away from Steve. He's done very well. But he's doing it in an environment that he can be the guy, he can be at the top. He couldn't be at the top in WCW.
All right.
You know, it actually sounds like he believes what he's saying.
I think he does.
And I think he doesn't, because Eric Bischoff is actually a little bit smarter than that, I'd like to think. And the fact of the matter is, I watched the whole interview. It said, you know, like he said in the interview, the numbers don't lie. Well, our ratings don't lie. When I'm on USA Network, those numbers don't lie. And I don't brag about merchandise sales, but
while we're at it, let's
while
do it.
We're at it, there no one in WCW or in the WWF for that matter can even touch me on that. So the numbers don't lie there either. As far as being a big fish in a small pond, anybody down in WCW will tell you, whether they're down there making good money or not, that the World Wrestling Federation is the show. It is the big time. WCW is a place to stay around and get some work, but everybody knows, and Eric Bischoff knows too, that the World Wrestling Federation is the big time, and that's the bottom line.
I don't know if he knows that, or if he does, he certainly didn't admit it on this show.
Well, of course he's
not. Like Vince doesn't know that WCW has, at times, kicked his butt across North America.
But then again, on that same interview, didn't Eric Bischoff say that they used to look forward to the ratings, and then it got to be they're beating us so much, it wasn't even fun anymore. Well, I think it's starting to get a lot more fun for him, because the rating race has been pretty damn fun the last few weeks. And with the 5-7 we just set, you know, not too long ago, was the highest rating ever for wrestling.
Right. There's no question that we should point this out to an audience that may or may not know. WWF has had a really good last little while. WrestleMania was the highest grossing of all times pay-per-view.
Right.
Highest rated show the past, your last Raw in the Vince McMahon, Steve Austin storyline. But I want to ask you, though, I want to go back to WCW and say, you got a phone call, right, from Eric Bischoff
right.
when he was your employer.
Right.
What did he say?
You know, I was recovering from a torn tricep I suffered over in Japan. And, you know, the arm was healing up, and basically he told me, based on the amount of days I've been incapacitated, based on the amount of days, on the amount of money they were paying me, that they were going to exercise their right to terminate the agreement. So I said, basically, you're telling me I'm fired. He goes, well, yeah, that's what I'm telling you. When you get well, maybe, you know, we can talk again. And, you know, getting fired doesn't bother me at all. If I get fired tomorrow, that doesn't bother me. But, you know, I live 30 miles from the CNN Center at the time. All you got to do is say, come down to the office, we need to talk. I just got pissed off that he fired me on the phone. I think it's a pretty lame thing to do to a person that works for you for 4 years.
Right. He fired a guy, though, who was not a star, right, in WCW at the time. I mean, there's no disputing. Eric Bischoff wouldn't even dispute it. You are a huge star right now. What is the difference? Why, in WWF, is your persona so enormous, and back there, you were just another guy?
Well, it was a whole political thing. When Brian Pillman and myself formed the Hollywood Blondes, they saw how that was taking off, and it would have been at the time, it was the hottest tag team of all time, and it would have been one of the best ever, and they shut that down for political reasons. So I never was given, you know, the platform down there that I've been given here in the World Wrestling Federation. When Vince McMahon brought me up here, and I changed the name I had in the beginning, the Ringmaster, to Stone Cold Steve Austin, finally he gave me that football, and when he did, I took off and ran with it. And I'm not dropping it, and I'm not giving it back, because, you know, this is my opportunity, and I'm going to make the most of it.
Hey. North Texas State University, your football
right.
player, were you?
Right.
What position?
Defensive end.
Not a very good one?
Damn good.
Damn good?
Not good enough to play pro ball, but enough to get a free education.
Let me ask you then, so as WWF, everything takes off, right. Your character. But isn't it true, though, that you have a lot more leeway in WWF, that the family values idea of WCW would not permit you to give the finger, would not permit you to use the F word, in other words, that you use, that really do attract fans. So this is the right place for you.
It's the right place for me. And
hearing Stone Cold in your voice, as you sort of get excited by the subject, how close is Steve Austin, the guy that I met, we sat in the green room, talked about families and stuff like that, to the guy in the ring.
That's the exact same thing, except sitting here 3 feet from you, you know, we're not in an audience, you know, where it's 20,000 people or 60,000 people, where I'm trying to project all the way to the back of that audience. So all I've done, you know, when I get on a Monday Night Raw or in a pay-per-view or whatever, in that situation, all I do is get that volume switch and turn it all the way up. But the two people are actually the same person, because I don't believe that, you know, you go out there, you could be something other than what you are, but what I'm doing is being myself. And I think, I guess that's why I'm so popular right now. All I'm doing is being myself. And I don't, you never really hear too many people say, Steve Austin's okay, I kind of don't like him, or kind of like him. Either you like me 100%, or you don't like me, and that's pretty much cut and dried.
Well, we've got to talk about the new hardcore of wrestling. Obviously, you represent a lot of that and where it's going. And we'll do that when Off the Record returns. We'll be back with Cold Stone.
All right,
Steve Austin.
That's Stone Cold.
I'm sorry?
Stone Cold.
It doesn't make any difference
right,
one way or the other.
It does.
Right?
It does. Why? It makes a big difference.
Go ahead. Call me Lansberg Michael.
Okay.
Doesn't bother me a bit.
Doesn't bother you?
Yeah.
It should.
That is, that's the definitive Steve Austin, right? Every working man's dream, to punch their boss in the groin.
Hey, it works for me. It works for me. It fit the situation. Mr. Man has a tendency to get on my nerves. Most of the time I talk to him right then, he tried to dress me up in a suit and make me the corporate good guy. And then, you know, I have to, you know, reaffirm everything. But that's not going to happen with me. I go out there and I do it and say whatever I want to do. And if he doesn't like me, you know, like I said, I've been fired before. I'm not afraid to get fired again. But I'm going to, you know, when I had an accident, you know, about a year ago, got dropped on my head and almost got paralyzed, you know, I realized that, you know, this thing doesn't last forever. So, you know, whether I'm around for a long time or not, I'm damn sure going to have a good time while I'm here.
Okay, well, let's talk about that. You know, I got a lot I want to talk to you about, the Vince McMahon thing, but you mentioned that you got dropped in your head, pile driver by Owen Hart.
Right.
Is there some animosity between you and him?
Well, you're
genuine.
Damn right.
I'm
telling you.
Yeah, okay.
You're damn right. When you talk about something as serious as that, you know, to lay in front of 20,000 people.
Did he screw up?
You're damn right he screwed up.
What did he do?
He dropped me flat on my head.
Usually, you
suffer a little jolt out of that, but not anything like I did. And lay there in front of 20,000 people, not being able to move an arm or a leg, you know, I'm still pissed off at, you know, about it, you know, to this day.
Didn't he come up with a T-shirt also that said?
I think someone else came up with
Hard,
a T-shirt.
No, but a Hard 316 and said,
yeah,
I broke your neck or something like that.
Yeah, I thought that was a pretty cheap avenue to go, but you know that's the way sometimes the wrestling business is.
But that is the way the wrestling business
is.
Well,
I'm not going to sit here and whine and complain about it. It just goes with the territory. That's the way it goes. If you're going to whine and complain about everything, you know, that's what Bret Hart did. You know,
he whined and complained about.
Yeah, you know, he always whined and complained.
You're in Bret Hart territory here, you know, Steve.
I don't really care what territory I'm in. You know,
what did he want?
I'm not going to cater to anybody. Like I said, I'm going to be myself. What's that?
Vince McMahon, your boss,
right,
lied to Bret.
No, I didn't.
Yeah, he did. You know why? You know how I know? Because he said on this show, I lied to Bret.
Did he?
Yeah, he did. He admitted.
Well, that's just the way it goes, you know. He was there 14 years, had a hell of a job. Didn't want to go with the flow. And basically, he got fired. Now, you can dress it up as anything you want, but to me, when I see why everything's happened, that's what happened. Business. That's the way it goes. It could happen to me. It could happen to anybody.
What about the direction that the WWF is heading? It seems like there really are no rules. That the key is create storylines that people like, whether good example of the Generation X, and I guess... some of us, parents, as you are a parent, would be offended by this.
Oh, yeah, I can't say that I agree with everything the World Wrestling Federation does. And, you know, I'm not going to sit on the high horse and say everything I do is right, because I know with my sign language and my language, you know, a lot of people don't like me, but it seems like a lot of them do like me. But as far as, you know, everything goes, I'm not really much for the sex stuff or the racism stuff on TV. Other than that, everything's pretty much fair game. Nothing really bothers me. But once you get into those two areas, then I kind of start really getting turned off.
It seems as though the fans have a hunger for aggression now that they didn't have in the past. Last weekend, wasn't there an Unforgiving? Kane was set on fire by Undertaker?
Right.
Like, how far can this go?
Well, I mean, his arm got caught on fire.
It could happen, right? You know.
Yeah. But, you know, of course, you know, the guy's just fine. But, you know, I think that's just, it's 1998. Things have changed. I mean, not just in wrestling, but in everything. And, you know, you really can't name anything that really hasn't changed and gotten more aggressive and football player gets bigger, stronger, faster. I mean, it's just everything keeps evolving. Now, I think you got to draw a line with some of the issues you get into. I know Vince says that anything should be available for him to do that. And it's his company, so I guess that's
he's the boss, and if you don't
that's
like it,
right.
I guess you
got
to move on. But you can't express your feelings to the boss.
Well,
I guess you did with this
right.
Show, right?
Well, I mean, he never sat there and asked me, Steve, what do you think about this or that? And if he did, I'd tell him. I mean, like I said, he's not afraid of anybody, and I'm not afraid to give him my opinion. It doesn't bother me
but
in the least.
Do you think the fans' hunger for aggression, though, is compromising your chances of staying healthy? I mean, they want more all the time. And there's a lot of guys, yourself. Look at Shawn Michaels there, and... he has severe back problems now, of course. Macho Man Savage, Buff Bagwell on live TV nearly broke his neck. Are they pushing you harder to do more, and therefore this is riskier business than it was?
No, I mean, you put yourself in certain positions, and either good things or bad things can happen. Most of the time, of course, we'd like everything to be okay, and to walk away and say, that was pretty cool. Sometimes bad things happen. It's not management saying, hey, you got to do this, you got to do that. It's guys... being so hungry that when you crank up a pay-per-view or live TV, you're out there. I think it wasn't my goal when I got in pro wrestling to be the second or third match every night. And that's not knocking anybody who is the second or third match. But, so anybody, the people you just named getting hurt, they had the same goal that I had. They want to go out there and steal the show. So they're turning up, they're turning up the volume themselves. It's their intensity driving them to do these things. And that's the hunger, and it's the price you pay to be on top.
Isn't it true also that the talent of some of the wrestlers is less now than it was, less prepared to be in the ring? Get a lot of guys who look great, great bodies, great physiques, a lot of guys who sound great, but don't have the same technique and don't have the same background that you have. A guy like Ahmed Johnson, for instance.
No, a lot of guys, when I broke in, I starred, I paid my dues, and for a year and a half there, and a lot of guys, paid the dues for a hell of a lot longer than I had to. And you got to learn, there's really no formal education. You don't get a degree. Someone says, okay, you're now ready to go out there and do it. The hell, you go out there and you might get in the ring with someone who doesn't know nothing. And so you're compromising your health right there. Maybe some steps should be done to try to get people to be a little bit safer, but that's just the facts. That's just the way it is. And tell a guy, okay, so you're going to give me a pile driver. Hell, you might not even give anybody a pile driver before.
I'm thinking you're probably not a big fan of Bill Goldberg's, are you?
Probably. No, I don't have any problem with Bill Goldberg. No, I haven't seen
you. Copy of you?
Well, like what they say, imitation is a most sincere form of flattery, or something to that degree.
Well,
I'm not, yeah.
We're going to take a commercial break, and maybe I'll shave my head and imitate
would
you.
Would you?
Probably not.
With that hair,
anybody who knows me, chances are they're thinking he ain't shaving his hair. We will take a break and talk about a very serious subject. Your good friend Brian Pillman went off the record returns. Well, that is the stutter, and there have been times in the show when I've actually agreed to do some wrestling moves with some of the guys.
Right.
I put in the sharpshooter with Bret Hart.
Right.
There will be no stutter on the show.
No stutter on the show.
Stutter on the show.
If you wanted to finish the show, it probably wouldn't be good for you because you wouldn't be talking or singing or doing anything like that. They'd probably do that little deal where they wrap your little jaw up. Really, you wouldn't feel too good if I did it to you. Promise you.
Yeah. I don't doubt that for a second.
No, but I wouldn't want to mess up yet. Wouldn't want to mess
I thought
up
maybe
here.
You'd fall for it for a second time.
No, okay, I'll try to give you the benefit of the doubt nothing.
Let me get serious, though, and your friend Brian Pillman. And your careers, obviously, you were together as a tag team duo. WCW, WWF, your careers paralleled one another. I want to ask you, you haven't spoken publicly about Brian Pillman that much. Your reaction to his death?
Well, we were at a pay-per-view that day when all of a sudden the news came out that Brian was dead. I mean, it was something that I really couldn't believe happened. And everybody always says, well, it didn't really sink in. It didn't until a few nights later we tolled the bell on Monday Night Raw, and it pretty much, shook me up. And Brian was someone I met down at WCW at a TV taping, and he came up to me, and he was fixing to put me with Harley Race and give me a good shove as U.S. champion. And he says, Steve, we need to come up with a finishing move. We're a tag team now. And I said, what the hell are you talking about? And, it was just an interim tag team. We turned into the Hollywood Blondes, and me and Brian, in wrestling, I guess in a lot of entertainment-type things, you really don't make any close friends because everybody's out there to stab you in the back. But Brian was one of the guys that he always called me at the house and always called him. We got to be the best friend I ever had in wrestling. And then when he died, it's something that is too bad. Brian had a lot of throat problems. He had his ankle fused. His health, he was in bad shape health-wise. That's personal problems at his house, I guess. And I guess everything caught up with him, and he had a heart condition on top of that. And that was the legal cause of his death, was a heart condition. He died in his hotel room, and it's just you know, a real sad thing for someone of Brian's intelligence, one of the smartest guys I ever knew, for something like that to happen. And not a day goes by that I honestly don't think about Brian, and I miss him.
Bret Hart said on the show that he wasn't close friends with him, but he considered him a friend, and he said that he felt somewhat guilty because he said people knew that he was struggling with his life. Do you feel any guilt?
No, you know, it's always that question of saying, you know, you wonder if you would have took it aside and said, man, is there anything I can do or what's going on? But the way I knew Brian, I mean, Brian, you know, during the daytime, I mean, he was the proudest guy, and you know, he was a strong, tough guy. He wasn't going to say that he had problems or this or that. He might whine or complain just in a sentence or two, but he didn't look for sympathy, and he didn't want it. You know, he was a very headstrong person. He wanted to do his own thing, and he always did. You know, he lived his life 100 miles an hour and had a great time. And just at the end, everything caught up with him, and it was a bad time. And like I said, I guess he had some problems at the house. And everything just caught up with Brian. But I don't feel guilty about it at all. You know, Brian went away, and I don't think there's anything that was going to change that. I guess it was just time.
Do you think wrestling contributed much to his death?
I think life contributed to his death. You know, I think it was just, Brian was 34, 35 years old, with the heart problem and all that, and all the pain he was in, and from the car wreck and everything. It was just, it was just something that happened.
Brian Pillman, a good friend of Stone Cold Steve Austin, and we have more to talk about. I want to get your impressions on some of the current guys that you're wrestling with and some guys from the past, and we'll do that when Off the Record returns. And we always invite your response. Hey, we responded to your request for this guy. Here's our addresses that you can reach us. Name of the show is Off the Record. This is Stone Cold Steve Austin, in demand for our show. Thousands of requests, and we got questions to ask you, and a couple of them actually pertain to me. I'm a tad concerned about this. Here's a sampling of what we received. You can give a comment. Stone Cold, what's your feel on Lansberg? Feel free to do to him what you did to Vince at Unforgiven.
Well, if you pissed me off enough, I would wrap a chair around your head and do whatever I felt necessary, but I'm trying to be civilized guest here on your show.
And you're doing a good job of it. And, you know, I'll have to say, a little bit intimidated as well, I think you are. Lansberg always seems to have the need to display his manhood by having guys such as yourself apply finishing holds on him during the final segment of the shows. If you'd like to get your hands on him, give the viewing audience a what?
I'd give him a hell yeah.
Okay. Keep your hands off me, okay?
All right.
Let me throw out a couple of names in a moment. Word association. We played it with Vincent. It was a lot of fun. But you have a big match coming up at Sky Dome, May the 23rd. You're going to face Hunter Hearst Helmsley. And the referee, we've just learned, is going to be Vince McMahon. What's the deal?
I think that's the biggest bunch of crap I ever heard. Because, you know, Vince McMahon has done everything so far that he can think of to try to get that belt off of me. And I'm his worst nightmare. So the fact that he's going to come up here to Toronto and try to, there's no way he's going to call it down the middle. I'll tell you that for right now. And Hunter Hearst to Helmsley on his own is tough enough. Yeah. But if you're going to put Vince McMahon in there,
okay, so
I'm probably going to beat his ass.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Let me throw out some names. Give me one line, one comment, whatever. Hulk Hogan.
He was very successful, but not a real don't.
Best there ever was?
No. Not even close.
No. That's Bret Hart, sorry. Best there was.
No, not even him.
No? Who is?
But they're both highly successful.
Who is the best there ever was? Wrestler. Greatest wrestler in history.
Well, one of the people I most enjoyed being in the ring with. Bret Hart was one of them. Ricky Steamboat.
Cool.
Yeah.
Sable.
Well, little chick.
God.
In trouble with that.
I just wish I was Steve Austin and I could do those things. Diamond Dallas Page.
He's actually a friend of mine. I have very few of them, but he's actually a friend of mine. He's a very hard worker.
Are any of your friends women, by the
way? Very successful. He's done very well for himself.
Shawn Michaels.
Extremely talented. Kind of started crying there a little bit at the end. Hopefully get his act together, get his health together, and come back to WWF.
Al Snow.
Right now, what he's doing, he might have a chance to actually do some good with it. He's got a pretty new gimmick with his head thing, and actually, it's pretty damn cool. We'll see what happens with it.
He's in the ECW, of course.
Yes, he
Mike
is.
Mike Tyson.
It was a lot of fun working with Mike. I'd still like to fight Mike Tyson. If he ever gets cleared or whatever, I want to wrestle him, I want to box him.
Do you think you'll work with him again?
I'd like to see it happen.
They pay him too much, or was it worthwhile?
Hey, you know, he's the king of pay-per-view.
Ric Flair?
One time he was great. It's time to hang it up.
Vince McMahon.
Pretty damn close to being a genius. A hell of a promoter. Do I like him? Do we see eye to eye? No. But I give credit where credit's due. He's pretty damn smart.
Well, before we go, I tried to anger you. They told me I had to do this.
You know, Regis did this stuff, and I let it go. But you're starting to piss me off.
No.
It's Austin 316. What does Lansberg 316 mean?
What
does Lansberg 316 mean?
That just means that on this show, I rule. We're out of time. Thanks for joining us, okay?
I'm going to see this. Ain't no way you rule, because Stone Cold Steve Austin rules.